Welcome to the Run the Roundup Show. We're back again for the next 2 hours with, of course, the podcast. I'm also on Facebook Live, and hopefully, if we can get a Wi-Fi connection, we'll also be on Twitter as well at some point during the evening. But a massive welcome, of course, to Glenn, who's back with us again.
Good evening, Dave.
And, of course, as well, we'll be looking forward to this one from Morden Tiptree as well. We've got Kevin and Mark, manager and assistant manager from Morden Tiptree as well. I know they've been looking forward to it as well, to coming on. I was speaking to Mark through Twitter. But interesting week. I suppose one of the things that I put onto Twitter this week was around, before we go into the results, was around a Hall of Fame. If you did a Hall of Fame, everybody seems to do it. It seems to be Premier League and wrestling companies and other companies all seem to do the Hall of Fame. I mean, if we did a Hall of Fame, I mean, what people would you put in? If we had to choose six people at the end of the season, like I put on Twitter, and that, we put six people in now, I mean, who would we be picking?
For 20 years.
Yeah, I mean, who would we be picking, even in Isthmian football, I mean, who would you think we would be picking to stick into that?
Off the top of my head, I'm thinking of the ones that when I was younger, and first coming, like Gary Ablett, who was an Aldershot forward, he used to score goals for fun. You've got Jimmy Mack and them sort of people from Thurrock and Hornchurch, been around the block more than once.
What about modern day people? So, I mean, your ex-boss was mentioned a couple of times as well.
Which one? About 50.
Mr. Billericay, I think.
Craig's been around
a couple of times. I mean, people like Alan Turvey, possibly as well. The old chairman of the league.
Morsley must come into it as well, wasn't he? Really successful at this level.
Yeah.
Terry Spillane.
Terry Brown, another one who had a lot of success at this level. There's loads, isn't there? Do you know what I mean? There's loads that you can think of.
Be interested if there's anybody out there listening on Facebook and that, to send that in. If there's anybody out there you think we could possibly honour in that way, we'd be really interested to know, because it's something that I think we could possibly end up trying to do through chess and trophies and stuff at the end of the year, and try and get something going as well. We will announce the team of the week as well in the second half of the show as well. I know Grays were winning by about 20% the last time I looked at some point during the day, so it'll be interesting to see whether or not they held on for the last sort of 2 or 3 hours today. So what we normally do, guys, we'll go through the games in the Prem, in the North and the South. We just have a chat about those, see where you think, if they were surprises for you or if you expected those to happen. So the first one then, I suppose, is Burdekin Town 1, Met Police 4.
I think it's a shock again, because for the last few years, Burdekin will get out of it purely because their home form's quite good. And I put a kiss of death on them, because I think they've lost every home game since, apart from the Canvey one. So I think the scoreline's more of a shock, 4-1, it sounds quite comfortable.
Met Police normally go on a bit of a run this time of year, though, don't they?
Jim knows this league inside and out, don't he? He always, pulls his teams away from safety or on the brink of the playoffs, So it's not a shock, really, but just, the convincing scoreline, really.
Canvey Island 1, Folkestone Victor 3.
Not a shock.
No, unfortunately.
No?
No, not for me.
I mean, I've not seen Canvey this year, but I saw Folkestone last night, and I don't know. They didn't necessarily jump out of the page at me, shall we say, last night.
But they get, in a week, they've won one draw and away from home, so, they must be solid and have a little bit about them, and Canvey needed, they was winning 1-0 and got out of the relegation zone against Burdekin, then they let an equaliser in, and they needed to win that, I think, but again, it's a good result for Folkestone, so credit to them.
The big game then, Dulwich Hamlet 2, Needham Market 0.
Not a shock for me, to be honest.
I think people look at that as a shock due to Needham's obviously position in the league. Dulwich Hamlet are an unbelievable outfit. And the manager there has been there a long time and done really, really well. So I expect them to be certainly up in the playoffs.
Yeah.
Mm. So not a massive shock, but obviously with the run that Needham's been on, some people will see it as one, I suppose.
Yeah.
Because they've got their big game the weekend.
Yeah.
I know they warmed up to that last night. Maybe you saw it, they had a London Cup match last night.
They
won 7-1 last night.
They did.
Against Barkingside. Grays 1, Billericay Town 0. Shock?
Huge shock. Huge shock for me. Obviously, the Billericay boys won 6-0, didn't they, last week, and by all accounts, it could have been 10-11. And to go there and, you know, get beat by Grays last minute, massive shock for me, because I thought they'd go there and steamroll the Grays, with all due respect.
A lot of people might say that, you know, the pitch that Grays play on is a bit of a problem, but then Billericay's pitch isn't that great either.
No,
so,
never has been enough,
so you know, you can't put it down to that type of thing.
I mean, did you see the goal?
Good free kick, great free kick.
Harrowborough 3, Leeston 1.
That's a shock. That's a shock. You know, Leeston, with their games in hand, I thought, you know, they're in a good position, which they still are, to be fair, but...
They had a little bit of a wobble, though.
Yeah.
Everyone does, don't they? Like you say, they've got a lot of games in hand. I expect them to be right up there.
Yeah, I mean, he's brought a few in, hasn't he, recently? Whether, you know, whether or not the wobbles happen when you're trying to keep more people happy rather than keep a, you know, consistent team, I don't know, but, yeah, I mean, like Kev said, I think they'll be right in the mix for the
179 out
of Harrow, I mean, they've picked up, you know, they won again last night. It's not a nice place to go in the summer, it's not a nice place to go in the winter. And, you know, they do get results at home.
Harrow, Waterlooville 3, Hendon 2. 702 there.
Good crowd.
As you expected.
Yeah, the only shot again is the closeness of it, to be honest.
And it's 3-2 at half time as well.
Mm-hmm.
Kingstonian 0, Tonbridge Angels 3.
No, not a shot there for me. Tonbridge are strong. And they're right in it as well, aren't they? So, no, not a shot for me.
Lowestoft Town 1, Leatherhead 0. Jimmy got a big job on his hands.
Yeah, well, like I said, after we spoke to him, what was it, 3-4 weeks ago? Keith was saying they were looking up, but they seem to have dropped on the second block now, haven't they?
Two games in hand. They've got 3 games on Grays. They've had 3 points deducted as well. They've got 2 games in hand on Canby and 1 in hand. And then Mersham, of course, have got 4 games in hand on them.
Yeah, so, I mean, they're in the mix. Mm. You know, they're in a dogfight now. They're playing tonight, aren't they?
We'll check it,
right? So again, that's a massive game, and for Sudbury as well, because they're not too far
away. Like a stone, isn't it?
Yeah.
Mersham 1, Harlow Town 0.
You were there, was you?
I wasn't, no. I was at somewhere else. I was in the North Division this week. But
that's a shock for me. You know, Harlow on the edge of the playoffs now, aren't they? So they're in form, and Mersham.
You'd say they've underperformed this year.
Yeah, I mean, I thought they was decent last year when we played them, to be honest. They had a little bit about them going forward, and they were quite solid at the back. And the signings they made in the summer, you would expect them to be top 10 at least, you know. And, like Mark said, they're underachieving. And on paper, you look at the table, that's a shock, isn't it? So,
if you look at that, they had, you know, such a great run in the FA Cup. And I suppose it's a little bit, I suppose, like a... If you sort of look up, you know, quite some way, you look at Leicester, and it's a bit like them, I suppose, as well. They've had sort of a really good run in the Champions League, and then sort of really struggling.
I think they seem to do better against the teams further up, because they beat someone 4-1 the other week that was up there as well. And you know, it just seems like the better teams that they play against, the better results.
There we go. Wingate in for you. So Staines Town 4, AFC Sudbury 0.
No shot there for me.
Staines coming into a little bit of form again.
Over
the last few weeks. He seems to have picked it right back up again.
Jack knows the league, don't he? Do you know what I mean? He knows how to win that league as well. And, you know, they sort of... They're still mid-table. 12. Yeah. But, you know, he knows that league inside and out, and you've got teams that get results.
Wingate Finchley 0, Bognor Regis Town 2. 180. Worthing 1, Enfield Town 3. 881 there.
For that one. Shock. No, not really. No, I mean, Enfield, Well, both of them are sort of in and around it,
but Edinburgh again, another team that had sort of a real sort of little sticky patch, didn't they, over the last two or three weeks?
Good result for Brad and the boys down there, because they needed that and to keep in touch. Mm. But again, if Worthing had won that one, it wouldn't have been a shock.
Worthing 3G as well, isn't it? I played there with Chatham. They were decent. Mm. They obviously got promoted. On the 3G, they play some football, to be fair. Mm. They kick the ball really well. So, I old man's up. I don't know this league that well, but I must admit, I would expect Worthing to pick up more results at home.
Well, they lost again last night, didn't they? 4-0 to Harrow at home. And, you know, they're stuttering a little bit. But they've played a lot of games.
And they seem to be an on-off side. They either turn it on or there's nothing there at all.
They seem quite a young side to me. Certainly in the league below when we played them in the south. Really young boys, maybe that had come out of academies, really good footballers, and maybe they were finding their feet in men's football.
I know they came over here and said, didn't I? And they didn't use expecting a real sort of, you know, as they call it, the El Plastico coming over there, and came over here, and it didn't really materialise to that, really. I mean, the person I feel sorry for, we've seen it a couple of times on the show, he's the Worthing goalkeeper, because he's had the Carew score against him for an absolute worldie for Dulwich Hamlet against him that had about 3 million views on YouTube all around the world, and then when they came here, Lane Idiot, another one that was on Soccer AM and all the rest of it. So he's had two sort of screamers that he's had against him. But the table then, this was as of Saturday evening, so it's Bognor Regis then played 34-68, Havant Waterlooville played 32-64, Needham Market 35-62, Tonbridge Angels 34-61, Leeston 30-55, Enfield 35-53, and then you've got Dulwich, Hamlet, Wingate and Finchley on 51, and Harlow then on 50. And at the bottom, Grays Athletic at the bottom was played 36-29, Leatherhead played 33-31, Canby 35-32, Hendon 34-32, Mersham 29-36, Harrowborough 29-37, AFC Sudbury 33-37. So it's all a little bit, still a little bit tight down there. Still see anybody adrift? Gray's picking up those points. I mean, is that going to help their cause? I mean, they play seven games more than that's the downside, I suppose. They play seven games more than Harrowborough and Mersham, which are the nearest two.
Yeah, that's the problem, man.
Yeah, I mean, obviously it does help their points tally, but and morale. But I just think the games played. You know, I hate to say it because it's an old club of mine and got a lot of time for people there, but it's just the games that he's going against them. Mm. You know?
Just can't see them putting a run of six wins together, which is what they're going to need to get.
But they've only got 10 games left as well, haven't they?
Yeah, exactly.
So it's...
I mean, if you go up and win 6-7, you've got they'd be asking questions, but...
They could still make the playoffs as well, by the way, just saying that.
I don't believe they can. Believe me, Dan, I don't believe they can.
I think at the other end, the top end, some of those sides... But Ricky's it's going to be incredibly difficult for them to break into that top five. I think if Leicester get it together and win a couple of their games in hand, that five are breaking away is going to be very difficult.
I think the team I'm a little concerned about, and we'll ask Mark about it because he's with us on Monday night on the phone on Monday, is Needham. Because when you actually go on the football webpage and have a look at the games that they've got coming up between now and the end of the season, it's probably only two of them that are probably outside the top 10. It looks horrifying.
I hope they stay.
I must admit, I think everyone at Nelson, I was at Needham a long time, would have they thought they'd have been in this position with this amount of games left? Probably not.
No.
So, have they overachieved? Probably. They'll take that, they're just trying to cling on to that now and stay, hang on in there in the playoffs, and then the lottery begins, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Anyone's got a chance then.
Yeah.
I think they'd be relatively pleased with where they're sitting in the table. Tough games ahead, but they've been winning games, possibly games that they shouldn't have been at times, but they've been picking up results, and that's a great sign.
If I'm not wrong, I'm sure it's Bognor Regis at the weekend. I'm sure
you've
told that.
They've asked me to say
on there that they're looking for local support. So if you want to go down and support Needham, they've got Bognor at the weekend. But again, another tough game. It's come one after another.
You've got to love it as a player, though.
Of course, yeah.
You want to be involved at the top end this time of the year. It's going to be great.
Rather the pressure at the top than the pressure at the bottom. That's
absolutely.
I think
it's one of those things, as you say, pressure, because I came down, I was filming the game last night, and I came downstairs, packed up everything, went home, and normally if it's a something happens like he did last night at the game. Danny's going absolutely bonkers in the dressing room. You could probably hear him up here, you know, where he's going. So, but it was as quiet as a mouse in the dressing room. And, you know, and someone came out and said, look, you know, I don't think it's just ridiculous. It's just stone quiet in the dressing room. No one's talking. Everybody's so sort of gutted about what, you know, what actually physically happened yesterday last night. But it was really strange to see, you know, not that type of noise that you expected. Everybody sort of screaming, shouting at each other, and it was just completely quiet. But do you still see then, is there anybody you see dropping out of that top four? Anybody going in? I mean, we always say Dulwich are going to get in there. So if Dulwich are going to get in there, is that going to be an expensive meter? Is it Tonbridge, Leeston? Are the top two sort of safe?
I think the top two are safe, yeah. Yeah. And I think Needham with a couple of wins will be safe as well. I think it's probably them four from probably Wingate up.
And see, if Leicester can get into the 60s with their games in hand, that's quite a gap between those five and what comes next. Mm. So
I think
it's going to be hard.
I think it's similar to like the North, that fifth place. It's probably up for grabs and it's anyone's, you know.
Well, let's jump into the North then, shall we? Let's have a look at the games from the weekend. Hornchurch 1, Sandown Rangers 0. No shot there?
No shot.
No?
That was only 1-0 maybe.
Yeah.
0-0 at half time. He scored in the 61st minute as well.
Yes,
what? Chorman.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
241.
Great as well, because
Tui
went back, that's why.
Yeah. Turning near,
isn't it?
Brighton Sea Region 3, Averley 1. Not we expected it to be tighter than that. I must admit, I was expecting it to be. I thought it could be a draw there when I saw that, because Averley, Terry, you know, very sort of experienced manager with no sort of. Probably how they play and how to stop them playing and stuff.
I think my heart was winning a draw. my head says Brighton City were going to win that. Because it's 3-1, does that surprise me a little bit? I thought it might be a little bit closer. But not seeing the game, maybe it was. I've not read any reports on the game, so maybe it was a little bit closer than the 3-1 suggests. But I expected it Brighton.
From what I read on Twitter, it was a lot of it. Is it Lamar Johnson? Kept over in it in the first half. I think he was put off some, you know, some super saves in the first half. He was a bit closer in the second half, but I think
Had a week that defines the season, but he'd had to pick up some points. You know, two tough games, and I thought they might have got a point. Like Kev said, it's the head and the heart. But you know, Brighton see they're on a very good run.
Chesnut 3, Great Wakering Rovers 1.
No shot.
And of course, the manager gone as well during the week as well.
Who
are we going to try and get these?
Yeah,
come on during in the next couple of weeks.
Had a little pick up in form, Chesnut.
Yeah, again, another team, a bit like we said, a couple of teams in the Prem, went on a real sort of like slow run and stuff, and you know, it's sort of an up and down one for them. Dereham Town 2, Thamesmead 3.
That don't surprise me really. It will surprise some people. Thamesmead, for me, were one of the better teams we've played. Their position in the league surprises me. They've just not been able to put a run of games together where they've ended up near the top. But that don't really surprise me, albeit Dereham are not bad either. But no massive surprise that.
I suppose the next one's got to be the surprise of the season, isn't it? Aybridge Swiss 1, VCD 2.
Yeah, on current form, Keith Lane, but yeah, no, I thought it would be a draw, to be honest with you. But fair play, they've gone there and, you know, got the 3 points that, you know, and Keith will admit probably that they massively needed as well. Good away win that, very good away win.
So the question is then, with those sort of 3 points for VCD, is that a situation where they were the lead 3 points they needed to for safety?
I
think they'd be safe, mate. That's a massive result for them.
And you know, I think they probably would need one more win to make 100% sure, and they'll get that for me. So, yeah. But against a team that was around them as well. It's a good.
That's the big thing.
Yeah, good win.
Still call it a season to play. So
yes.
It's a lot of twists and turns.
Yep.
Both ends of every table.
Yeah, and thank you just for that, mate, of class as well. Norwich United 4, Romford 1.
Not a shock.
No.
I think they're going to nick the fifth place.
Really?
Yeah. A lot of people look at me and say, you must be mad. I just think that they're on a run. And I think they're going to surprise a few people over the coming weeks.
Yeah, we had that chat last night, like saying they've got Andy Christie Finch. And I thought that was all they missed when we played them. Mm. They were strong.
They are a strong outfit.
Strong in the middle. They had a little nippy blonde boy. The 10.
Very good goalkeeper.
Very key. Yeah, the keeper was good. And if they've added him, he'd guarantee his goals.
Yeah, I just look at them. I went over to watch them actually play Brighton. They just look like a team of men to me. That a big, strong, physical, and can play a little bit. And the outside.
Very surprised is that Romford have gone right off the board again, haven't they? You know, I mean, we had them in the studio, and at that sort of stage, they were doing really, really well. And then, sort of, you know, Chindu scoring goals for fun as well.
It just seems to have
a little bit of a brick wall.
But maybe, you know, psychologically, they are probably safe now, aren't they? And, you know, they can take their foot off a little bit, I suppose. Not that they'd admit that, you know, they wouldn't want them to, but, you know, psychologically.
Yeah, 11 points.
Yeah, they're
Phoenix Sports 2, Wroxham 0. In front of 67 people.
Wow.
I'm sure.
Well, it's no shock. And they must still be hoping to get
that 2nd
place
as well.
Yeah, big Chester, yeah. It was a big Chester, mate. Last night, yeah.
Yeah.
Thurrock 4, Berrytown 0. Better weekend than the weekend before?
Yeah, definitely. As the boys see firsthand, yeah, it was not a good weekend the previous week. And we needed to bounce back, you know. Just bounce back a bit of it. You need to bounce back after a defeat just to keep in it. And, I mean, the scoreline, I've got to be honest, shocked me because Bury are a decent team, and when was the first goal?
28,
yeah, for the first near half an hour it was a very tight game, and then we just sort of got a foothold in it, asked a few more questions, and three quick goals, and then it was, you know.
I think that's a sign of a good team, isn't it, that when obviously you lose just the week before, and you potentially start questioning yourselves, and God, if we lose today, what's going to happen? And it's resounding victory, isn't it? 4-0. Yeah. Berrytown spent a lot of time near the top as well, so no pushovers, that's a great result.
Yeah, no, it was pleasing because obviously, you know, I said last week, no making any excuses for us because you boys are different class. But you sort of, where our squad's young, you sort of think they didn't turn up for that game, and you know, yourself included. And you know, Kev said you're asking questions and thinking, how do you bounce back? And to be fair, well, two of the boys that didn't have great games, went and scored and played really well, and it was pleasing to get a 4-0 because, you know, we've got some big games coming up, so a little bit of a confidence boost for everyone, which was good.
The game that I was at the weekend, Waltham Abbey 1, Brentwood Town 0, 96 there to watch.
And what was that like?
Move on.
Was it shut though?
No.
No.
To be really honest with you, I was looking forward to seeing Reynolds,
Lamar.
Play. Didn't really have probably the best of games, but then again, I don't think it was his, in the long run, was probably down to him. He just didn't get given any service whatsoever. And I think he was scaring, you know, you could see that he was going to scare the guy, you know, there at the back, but it was just a nothing game. And I know you guys speak about Brentwood and say that they'll get out of it, and for me, I think possibly the three that are there, or even the three will go. I was twice this season I've seen Brentwood play, and to be really honest with you, and I'd probably get absolutely slaughtered for saying it, but I'm as surprised they're as high as they are.
Again,
psychologically,
that's it, yeah. Thanks, mate. When they beat us, it was, there was comments, that's it, we're staying up. Maybe in their heads, they thought they'd done enough.
We had a tough time there, actually, as well. Well, I think we scored two really late goals, didn't we?
Nash got bent one in the top corner with 5 minutes to go or something.
We dominated possession on the day, but they were fairly solid, defended really well, and we ended up nicking it in the end. But
I think it's coincided with Waltham Abbey winning three or four games in quick succession, and they've sort of pulled themselves right away, haven't they?
They pulled themselves away. I don't think they necessarily at the weekend had probably played, and I think Walker Murray guys would say. Yeah.
He gets goals.
I don't think they had to probably play that well to get the win, personally.
They've had a lot of injuries that have sort of finished, and the better boys are back in the side, and that coincides with the wins.
Yeah.
I mean, for me, the weekend, I'm back there again on the weekend. I'm going back there to see Keith, if he's got through his dodgy back, but... I'll go down there and give him a bit of jip, but... Would I expect to see BCD win on Saturday? Probably give it a kiss of death now, but yeah, I probably will. Probably see them win that at the weekend. Where one, more than Tiptree two.
Game of two.
No shot there.
Game of two. Hard.
Yeah, the tough game, the tough place, and it was one that obviously everyone expected us to win, which again makes it tougher. First half we were really good. I thought on a difficult pitch that they're a big physical team, quite direct. We dealt with it really well first half, going 2-0 up, and you think, here we go, we could get a few goals here, and it'd be comfortable. They scored, I think it was 5 minutes after half time, was it? 3 minutes. And we tried to give it away, and they probably feel a little bit aggrieved that they've not got sacked from the game.
See, I think, again, their position is a little bit false for me, where, like, we played them cut time. I think it was a good game both times. Mm. There was only one goal, like, your Saturday difference. And it's not an easy place to go to.
But you play sort of far up the week before. I'm not sure if you had a game in the midweek, but you played far up the week before, which on paper you'd look at and think, this one could be a bit of a nightmare, it's going to be a tough old game. And then you win that one, and that just gets, quite comfortably. And then you go into somewhere where all of a sudden the mindset may be a little bit different. You go into it and think, well, it's one that we should win. Does that affect
It don't affect me. I'm quite big on that. If you're going to be successful, they're the games you've got to win. Generally, in the big games against, if you call them big games, the ones in the top six, lads generally get themselves up for that. If you're going to be successful and get out of this division like we want to, like Farrell, you've got to beat the teams that are lower down the league, away from home, on a cold, wet day. So I'm quite big on that, and I keep feeding that into the lads. So, yep, we turned up for 45 minutes, tried to give it away, but we didn't, thankfully, and walked away with 3 points. But
again, that serves a sign of a good team, because you've stuck it out in 3 points. That's a big...
We would have potentially lost that early on in the season.
Yeah. Apparently we've got dreadful away form, but still being top for 21
minutes.
can't be that bad.
I mean, you look at this, before we go on to the last one, the last two, but to me, this season's got a little bit of a... of the one two or 3 years ago with Ian Mark and Harlow, where he was only pointing it all the time and it was going right. I know it's a little bit different this time around because I know the two teams a couple of years ago played each other the last but one game of the season, so it was a real sort of humdinger right down to the very, very end. But again, it looks as if it's going to be that type of season where it's going to be, I'm not saying it's going to be a two horse race, but you've got two people there that will be in sort of, well, there's nothing there, there's any goals now, isn't it, between the two of you. So it's very, very sort of...
It's very tight. It's not a two-horse race, it's a four-horse race, because Glenn's side and Jimmy's side at Hornchurch, they've got to play Brighton Sea, and Brighton Sea got some other tough games, and they're all going to believe that they can get points, and if anybody has a bit of a wobble, these guys are only 6 points behind us. Behind us.
I think that's a little bit harsh on Bowers as well, to be fair. They've got games in hand, that they've been winning games recently. They fancy the chances if they win the games against the lads in and around the playoffs, and Chesnut as well. They're going to the way. I've been in football long enough, not yourself.
Yeah.
It's never clean cut. Mm. And it's important that you don't think that, because as soon as you think that, that's when you come undone. When we were 9 points clear at one point, everyone thinks it's done and dusted, gives the trophy. I was like, no chance. And there'll be another twist and turn, no doubt about it.
Yeah, and the thing is, like I said earlier, you've got to embrace it. Because if I say it to the young boys, there's no pressure. Just go and play, win games, and see where it takes you. If it's not good enough, then it's not good enough. And you might have to go through the back door. But, like I said, I'd much rather be at the top now, that sort of pressure, than, scrapping it out down the bottom, because...
Well, it's not pressure, is it? As you say, you go and play with freedom. It's exactly where you want to be.
Yeah, no,
enjoy
right.
it.
Yeah, definitely.
We've got Witham Town 1, Haringey Borough 2.
Not a shock, but Witham's a difficult place to go. And Haringey's another side that are going to influence what happens. They're going to influence what happens.
So late winner. Not a massive shock, but a little one, because I really like Witham. I think the management staff are really good, that they give us really two tough games down there, and when they break, they break with pace and got that bit of quality. Obviously, it was a last-minute winner for Haringey, who again, they're quite up there.
Yeah, they're very similar, when they attack, they've got all guns blazing, don't they?
So I know Rafiq's Kingston, isn't he? He says he thinks he might be the one that might sneak in as a 16 there, sneak in. But it'd be, as you say, it's going to be really interesting. I mean, Hornchurch, as you say, they've just brought in two, haven't they? You know, and
they've added good, vibrant Prem players.
You know, and very strong at the back, aren't they?
Yeah. And like, I mean, watched the semi-final last year between Farrick and Hornchurch, and they were very good on the day. And you wouldn't want to play them, you know. But then whoever's in the playoffs going to be four very, very good teams. So, do you know what I mean? It's not done and dusted yet.
Do you see Hornchurch is having a little bit of a weakness? But they seem to deceive sometimes, where they go up against teams that you would really expect them to beat. A bit like, I suppose, yourself with Ware at the weekend. You know, they go to the sides, and if you look at it, you think, yeah, they're going to win that one quite easily. And then you see the result, and it goes the wrong way.
Recently, I wouldn't say they've got a weakness, because we played them on the 3rd of January, and I think they've won 6 or 7 and drawn 1 since then. So they, at the minute, you can't see, and they've added really well, to be fair to them. So at the minute, obviously every team's got a weakness.
If you go back to the start of the season, where they drew a lot of games, they clearly needed a bit more firepower. George Purcell was injured, wasn't he? They didn't have Ross Wall at the time. But now they've added Tui, and Ross has come in, and Leon's getting goals.
Yeah, got Teddy Nesbitt on the left mid, and he scored a lot of goals last year, so...
No, I think what issues they had, Jimmy's probably sorted them out, and they're going to be really tough.
Mm-hmm. And of course then, on Friday night game, was Bowers and Pixie 4, Tilbury 0, 257.
I was at this game. I think every manager in the Ryman was there, so pushing up the crowd numbers. There's lots and lots of people there. Tilbury had a lot of players leave during the week. The goalkeeper's gone because of work commitments. And a few of the other lads have gone. So a lot of 21s playing inside.
Jack Barham's injured, isn't he, as well?
Yeah, and the 21-year-old kids just couldn't cope with Bowers' experience. And Bowers are a very experienced side. They scored from, I think, 3 or 4 goals were from restarts. And it was comprehensive, to be honest, as the score says.
So the table then, this was as of Saturday, of course. Morden Tiptree played 36 with 75, Brighton City 34 with 72, Hornchurch 36 with 69, Thurrock 35 with 66, Chesham 35 with 63, Bowers 34 with 61, Haringey 36 with 59, Norwich 34-57 and Phoenix 35-56. At the bottom, Great Wakeham have played 36-23, Wroxham have played 34-23, Brentwood have played 35-31, Soham 35-35, Ware have played 34-38, and then you've got BCD and Heybridge both on 39. So do you see, I know you said, Mark, that you see Norwich getting in there, but anybody else?
Yeah, I can see Norwich getting in there. I can. I think,
yeah. It could easily. It could be Chesson, Bowers, Haringey, Norwich. For me. But I do fancy Norwich to nick it. Mm.
If you were to say, well, 3 out of 4, because obviously yourselves and Brighton see, what would you say?
I think the top four will be the top four. Not sure what order, but that'll be the top four. Yeah.
I'm not going to sell the fence. I think we'll win it, and the rest of the house will be in the playoffs.
What does it sense?
Yeah.
Be two cracking semi-finals if that was the case.
What would it be?
Brighton, CB, Chesson, Hornchurch, Thurrock.
You've got to be in to win it, haven't you? As simple as
that. That's not me being that. Obviously, I'm more the manager. Yeah, I was going to back us all the way and put that out there. Obviously, if I thought any different, then there'd be no point me being the manager. Like you say, there's some great teams, you know. And there's going to be some good teams missing out, by the way, as well. So, yeah, exciting times.
It would be nice, you know, sort of like local wise, if you can get to games. Sort of, if you're a local person around sort of the Essex area, you want to see Thurrock, Chesham, Bowers, and Haringey, wouldn't you? Really, get to wherever they are, you don't get to see them. At the bottom then, Great Wakering. Gone.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, too much. Yeah.
Wroxham.
Say the same as well.
Yeah.
Who's the last one?
Me personally, I think it's Brentford.
I think Ware won't get dragged into that. From playing them Saturday, I think they just have too much. The new manager's gone in there. Like I said, they're a big physical side. Difficult place to go. I think they get enough Ware, so he's...
I think it'd be Brentford, and the reason I think it won't be Soham is that Soham got a lot of boys that have played this football. Now, Brentford side, a lot of them have come out of the Essex Olympian League and Essex Senior League. And I think they might not have the nous to stay up.
Mm. Yeah, I must admit, I personally think it'd be the three that are there. I don't see. I gave Wolf maybe a kiss of death the other week, you know, sort of winning things. So, but yeah, no, it's. I think it will be those. Unfortunately, it'll be those three. I think it's.
It's not nice to say, is it? You know what I mean? Because you know people, all the clubs, but. As I see it, I think that's what it'll be, personally.
And then everybody will be looking for that FA directive of reprieves and so you can stay in, that's such an Ryman Southden, Carl Shorten Athletic 2, Cray Wanderers 1. Tony's Cray.
I think it's a bit of a shock because Cray have picked up a few wins lately, didn't they? Mm. And Carl Shorten, I mean, I know they're in the mix in the playoffs, but they've dropped a few points lately. So
they lost last night as well for Hastings.
They did, yeah. Go
up
with them later.
They're flying. Guys, you know anything about those two?
We played Grays twice last year, and I thought they were a very, very good side. And I'm quite surprised to see where they are in the South.
I am, yeah.
They should be in the top five at least.
I don't know anything about the South, but people kept telling me it's not as strong as the North. But clearly it is quite strong, because Grays were a very good side in the North last year.
Yeah. Chatham Town 0, Dorking Wanderers 3, 169. East Grinstead Town 4, Chipstead 3.
That could go either way, isn't it? Down there.
But Matt's done quite well since he came on the show. He's done the opposite, hasn't he? He sort of lost the night after to Godalming.
Yeah.
And then after that, they seem to have picked up quite nicely in that game. It was 115 in there. I think this is a big shock. Faversham Town 3, Corinthian County was 0.
Well, Keith has always said that Faversham were underachieving this year, didn't he? Mm. And
they're normally always up there.
Yeah.
When I was in at Chatham, they were always up the top, flying high.
Corinthian Casuals have been around the top six pretty much all season, and that's quite a convincing win if you look at it like that.
Greenwich Borough 2, Walton Casuals 1. Herne Bay 3, Godalming Town 2. Maybe not a shock, but they seem to be getting closer. And that's a nicer thing to say.
Last night, there's only one goal. Before, it was like 10, wasn't it?
Yeah. So at the minute, they've played 35, considered 109. So that puts into some kind of context of what they were shelving at one stage. 218, yeah? So that's just one of the things. You look at that sort of attendance of 218 last Saturday. Herne Bay are 18, Godalming are 24th and almost, 25th almost, if you know what I mean, in the context of things. Now, I know there's a lot of talk recently about crowds and about how many people get and how many people don't get. And I think one of the things I saw during the week was you only get a decent crowd if you're doing well. Well, so that proves that completely wrong, doesn't it? Because all of a sudden, they
get
218.
That's what I'm saying. Like when we played you guys last week, it was like not even 200.
Yeah, no.
Do you know what I mean? That's crazy to think that.
Hive Town 1, Three Bridges 1.
Yeah, I think that's a shock, to be fair. I thought Hive would have won that.
Lewis 1, 2, Mitcham United 5.
That's a shock, the size of the scoreline.
Size of the crowd as well, 769.
Oh, that would have been rocking as well, David. Yeah. But yeah, no, the size of the score is a shock to me. Not necessarily the result, because again, two good teams. Lewis on form as well, isn't at the moment. So yeah, just the size of the score.
Sittingbourne 2, Moseley 0. 100 there. South Park 1, Ramsgate 3. And Whiteleigh 3, Horsham 1.
No.
So, top of the table, two team Mitchell United paid 34 with 77. Dorking Wanderers paid 34 with 74. Carshalton Athletic paid 35 with 67. Greenwich Borough 33 with 63. Griffith Casuals paid 34 with 63. High Ever paid 33 with 62. Lewis have paid 34 with 61. Hastings have played 32 with 58, and then Cray are in ninth down with 33 and 56. At the bottom, Godalming have played 35 with 15. It seems every week now, they seem to have more points than the week before.
Brilliant, isn't it?
So it's good.
We've got to get a show there, I really want to go there.
Three Bridges 33 with 20 points. Chatham have played 35 with 22. Guernsey played 35 with 29. Moseley have played 32 with 30. And then Chipstead have played 34 with 31. Bottom three all down.
It looks that way, unfortunately, doesn't it? And it hurts me to say it. Chatham, I had 6 months there as my first managerial job in men's football. Loved it. Potentially, could be massive. On a shoestring, it was really difficult. And well, it's been proven they've chopped and changed managers since. And really struggled to get a run of games together. It looks the bottom three down to me, unfortunately.
And as Keith has said on numerous occasions, it's just the shame thing about it is they've wanted for so long to come out of the North Division, go into the South Division. Oh, is it second year they're in the South Division? And now it's, you know, they're struggling to hold on to Eastern football now. It's a real shame down there. But there's the other one as well down there. And I went on BBC Guernsey at the beginning of the year, and they were talking about, Dave, tell us who you think will be our challenges at the top end of the league. You know, and it's gone really badly this season, to say the least. And you know, 35 and 29 points, and they're even sort of, you know, getting beat at home as well.
Wearing off.
You know,
that is a massive shock to me. Like I say, we played them last year. They was really good last year. They looked the part. They turned up with a coach. They just looked the part, and they had some really good players. Scored a load of goals. That is a massive shock. How far down that?
I mean, you've. If you played against them, I mean, I played against Ross Allen, but of course, Ross is not there at the minute, he's gone out travelling. So,
right.
You know, if you lose somebody, I suppose, that sort of, you know, that goal.
He played in the trophy over there the other year, and he was a threat the whole game. I think he scored that though as well. Mm.
I think there's a few pro clubs looking at one of these.
I spoke to one of the shows we had in the last series we'd done at the show was. I spoke to Matt Letizio. Matt came on and was talking to him and stuff, and he said that, you know, he's had offers from League One, and he reckoned he'd be a top goal scorer in League One. Was one of the things he said. He said he's that good. He said, but he said he didn't want to leave Guernsey. He loves Guernsey and didn't want to go, and that's the reason why.
His goal ratio is incredible at the time, isn't it?
Yeah. Take that out of a team, then you're
going to
win,
yeah.
Whatever level you're at.
I mean, with the leagues, I mean, some of them are, you know, they look really tight. I mean, the top two in the south have probably pulled away a little bit in Tooting and Dorking, and it'll be interesting to see if those are the two that go up. But
well, four down to nines, the point spread is quite tight, isn't it?
Mm. Yeah. And, you know, Hastings have come right into the mix, haven't they, with last night as well.
Mm. I suppose it's a shame when you look at those clubs, you know, even in your yourselves, what, both on 75, is it both on 75 now?
75.
Yeah, both on 75, and then you look at Tooting and Dorking 77 and 74, and it's one of those things where it's almost as if it's come 1 year too early, where next year it's two up. It's almost a case of, like, yeah, that sounds like a silly thing to say, but it's almost come sort of 1 year too early for both sides, because... 9 times out of 10, and I know we were on the wrong end of it with Needham. You know, we both scored over 100 points, and we didn't, you know, we turned up to the semi final and got turned over. Do you know what I mean?
So it's, that way, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's not a nice thing when you sort of, you know, a point behind the leaders or whatever else at the end of the season, or even goal differences, you know, whatever it may be. It's a bit of a nightmare. But the games then, I suppose in midweek, I mean, we've had a few. Phoenix beating Chester home as well.
That's a bit of a shock to me, to be honest.
That surprised me.
It's a great result.
That sort of puts them back in the mix a little bit. I know they're outsiders, but they'll take massive confidence from that result.
They've also had, I mean, the one here last night, you know, 2-0 up in 88 minutes and end up with a 2-2 draw, which...
I think the size of Brighton's win last night is where it surprised me. Not the fact that they won, but the size of the win.
Was a guy got hat-trick, didn't he, on his debut, didn't he?
Yeah, Billy Hunt.
Did he forward?
Yeah, so I mean, I suppose all the leagues, when you look at them, is no one really that sort of, you know, even in the Prem, you know, you've got Bognor and Hammond Waterlooville, so he's only sort of what, 4 points there, so, and they've got two games in hand as well, so it's every league this year is not something that's actually running away. I know you guys would probably want it the other way around. You want to run away. But it is that sort of situation where you look at it and go, you know, it's not. There's no one, and it's exciting for the fans, I suppose, of both clubs or all the clubs that are involved, and it's going to be a real sort of run to.
Yeah, it's an exciting end, certainly in our division as well as the others. It's unbelievably tight. Brighton's here, obviously, going to think. They're going to win it, obviously, because where they are, they obviously ain't going to say that. But they're going to keep plugging away. And Thurrock, Hornchurch, Chesant, Bowers, they're all going to think they can win it. I think you've got to. And that's why, at the start, when I took this job on, I said I want to win this division. I didn't shy away from it. I wanted to put myself under pressure. I said we've got a competitive budget. I didn't want to hide behind that and pretend I hadn't. And I want to win the league, and yeah, I think we will. Might end up with egg on my face, but I believe in the players I've got.
Our young group is certainly talented enough and capable enough to go and win the last 10. Whether we do or not, we'll see. But we've certainly got the ability.
That's the attitude you have to take. That's the same with us. I said, even in the huddle the other day, you've got to win the games at 12. You win 10 of them, you don't matter.
You could win it, yeah.
Yeah. And I said, I believe we can do it. If you haven't got that attitude, then you're on game.
I think everyone goes about their business their own way, and I respect whatever anyone does. I believe if I'm confident in what I say and what I believe in, hopefully that'll rub off onto the lads and not have the reverse effect where it puts them under pressure. I believe in them when I tell them that.
They can't really be under pressure because we've had the same message from pre-season. We're here to win the league. We think we're capable of winning the league. And we expect you guys to perform and to do that. Yeah. And so there can't be any more pressure than what they've had from day one. So.
Yeah, we weren't being brazen when we sat. Obviously, I've been in football and I know a lot of these teams. And I know that we can go down tonight. There's a load of massive clubs there with good managers and good players that want to do the same. So it was never going to be a cut and dry thing where we was going to run away with it. But the message has never changed from what I say and what the players think what we're trying to achieve. So hopefully, we're a young team, hopefully they can stand the test of time and deliver the potential that they've got and get more than next level up.
Well, like I said, like from the start of the season, you set out to win the league, as everyone does, but you look at it and that division is the hardest I've seen that division.
Yeah, it's tough.
For a long while, I said it's good to get out of the issue because next year potentially could be even more difficult. There is some big teams in that division, and it's been tough. It's been very tough this year, but enjoyable at the same time because you're always playing good games, which is always a bonus.
Because you look at that and you think, so if you look at the four teams that are, at the bottom in that, in the Royal Prem this year, they've got one that would go to south and three would go into the north.
To get stuff on.
And they're not small sides either, are they? Hendon, Grays, and Cambridge. Do you know
big
what I mean? They're extremely big clubs.
It's a trophy winners, isn't it?
Yeah.
So, I think Hendon won it all, isn't
it? Well, you look at Hendon. I mean, Hendon, you got promoted, what, two seasons?
That year, that was the best team in the division for me. Obviously, it's silly to say when they finished second, but they was different class. And then the next season, because one of our lads went to Hendon, the goalkeeper, Joe Wright, and he couldn't put his finger on why they had the same squad. I think the only one that changed at the start level was him. Whether it was him or not, I don't know. It sounds like it, doesn't it? But no. But he said the same team, just like Leicester this year, same sort of scenario. Just sort of devoid of confidence, and you know, winning's a habit, isn't it?
I think that's a massive thing. I think when you get on a run of games, when we had our run of winning games, it does become a habit, and you turn up. Not arrogant, but you have a little bit of swagger and you go out and you just end up performing. And there'll be games when maybe you don't perform but you're still winning it. It just snowballs. Mm-hmm. And on the flip side, it can happen the other way.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Yeah. I mean, I suppose, is there one side then that you see this year, and maybe you might still have to play, do you see banana skins anywhere for any of the teams that you've got?
There's banana skins all over the place. Yeah. All the teams. Yeah. But our running on paper, as everyone tells me, is probably the kindest out of everyone's, but I look at it and we play Brentwood, we play Soham, fighting for their lives. Mm-hmm. They're all banana skins when you're travelling away to games. Obviously, I don't want to put the kiss of death there, but home games, I'd like to think we'd have a real good chance of winning with our home form, but away games are tough. We found that already. We lost away at Haringey. We've lost to teams where we...
Was that a rainy night?
No. It wasn't a rainy night, no, but we weren't great that night. And we've lost games away from home where people thought we were bankers to win. Mm. So there is banana skins. Obviously, there's some tasty fixtures as well. We have to go to Chesham. Brighton City, I think, play yourselves, Hornchurch and Chesham and Haringey. So there's banana skins. And like I say, there will be twists and turns. All I will say is whoever ends up winning it will have earned it, and deserved it.
Yeah, I agree with that. Totally. I think banana skins everywhere. And when the teams, you know what it's like in football, especially non-league, the teams that are struggling, the players who are in them teams, they're thinking in the back of their head, if I go down and I play well against them boys up there, you know, so that's why it becomes difficult against teams down the bottom, because it's a shop window for them as well. And you say, like, we slipped up at Brentwood the other week when we absolutely dominated, but I think it's 2-1. They're fighting for their lives, and that's how it works. They're the games that I worry about more than anything, is the ones against the teams down the bottom.
I mean, the actual league itself. I mean, you see the teams, and it seems to be sort of this sort of time of year. All of a sudden, everybody sort of goes along, and we're getting close now. And what I'm saying to the transfer deadline as well. And how do you look at it now as manager, assistant manager? Are you happy with what you've got? Do you look at it and think maybe, you know, are you a bit like what Brighton City have done in the week, where they've gone out and got Billy Hunt and got somebody like that in as well?
And Connor Hogan, Pip Boyle.
They've got these people in. So, you know, would you look at yours and think, well, we could do an extra couple, or we're more than happy with what we've got? We'd rather have a settled team and squad and carry on that way.
I'm happy with what I've got. Different to what people think. We have actually got a budget that we have to stick to, so I can't go out and get whoever I want. I'm more than happy with who I've got. We've obviously signed a couple of young lads from the under-18s at Colchester, lads that haven't played men's football, so if we did have injuries, they would come in and step in for us. But I'm confident with what we've got. They've done well. We're not a massive group. We've stuck together and got to where we are with them players. So barring a ridiculous amount of injuries, we're going to be out for the rest of the season. I'm going to stick.
Because this year as well has been a weird year, because normally you see at least somebody in that sort of top six, top eight, where they're sort of eighth or seventh, and everybody's sort of taking their eye off them a little bit. But then when you actually look in the non-league paper, or you look on football web pages or the Ryman site or whatever you're looking, you look at it and think, they ain't out of it yet, because they've got about seven games in hand, because their pitch is really bad and they ain't played three on those hours. And that doesn't seem to happen this year, is it? It's not happened at all, where there's been one team that's got a load of games to make up, and now the ones you've got to keep a little bit of an eye on, as well as maybe the ones that are around you.
Yeah, nobody's had in that particular division, nobody's had a big FA Cup or trophy run against left in the games in hand.
I mean, that's the only thing really. If you look at the two, you know, you've got Haraborough and Mersham in the Ryman Prem, you know, they've got loads of games in, you know, more games in hand than that. And yet Dulwich Hamlet, of course, they've got their massive game, you know, this weekend, you know, they're still in that, and they've played 32. You know, so there's not too many, even in the South Division as well, they've all played 32. I think South Park got 27, but most of the others are up to 33, 36, 34, the same sort of thing in the north as well, where it's sort of 34, I think, is the lowest amount of games in there, and then you go up to someone like Thamesmead who play 37. So it's all sort of running quite nicely.
It's nice for once to be this time of the year not having to play Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday.
Yeah, I've been there before. Cool. Yeah, that's difficult. That. But it's again, there's so many twists and turns in all three divisions. It's going to be, you know, like I said, it's cliche. You've got to have one game at a time, haven't you? Yeah. You know, chalk that game off, get 3 points.
I think it's important to just concentrate on yourselves. Like, I know people say, oh, Brighton see one midweek. I just won't forget that. I know it is difficult at times when you're up there and obviously that's hard done. I think you just got to concentrate on, like, we've got 10, 11 games left. Let's just concentrate on us. What will be.
So do you guys not look at that? You know, especially, I mean, we use Brighton as an example because they're the ones that are sort of the closest to you. Do you sort of look at that, or do you, I know a few seasons ago I was told not to, I always give out the half-time scores, I always give out the full-time scores over the tunnel when I do the tunnel here. And I was told, well, you don't give out the score at half-time because I think at the time it was Tilbury, and I think it was the year that, unfortunately, it was the year I think that Morden sort of went a bit right at the top of the year.
The short answer to that question is no. We'd be lying if we didn't look at our phone straight as soon as the game's ended.
It's hard not to, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is hard not to.
But during the game, no, obviously.
It was once, when you, I think you was winning the other week, we played Wigan, was losing, and we come out, and they was doing, it was weird, they was doing the half-time scores as we were coming out, and it was like Morden winning, and we was losing, it was like, oh,
yeah.
Okay. And, but, do you know what I mean? I think, you know, the boys are right, afterwards you look, and you go, but, you know, if you're winning and asking questions, that's all you can do, you can't do nothing else. You know,
I think that's a good place to be in, when you've won your game, and then you have a look, because then it's cherry on top of the cake, isn't it?
If
people have dropped points in and around you.
Yeah.
So what happens if we go down and just before we finish for the first half and just go and close off for the first half, and we'll come back and talk more about Morden in the second half. But what happens then in the go down to the last game of the season? There's a point in it. No points here between maybe you, Brighton, Seat, Thurrock, Hornchurch, which is possible. With, you know, with how close it all is in there. What happens then? What's that? Are you with your phone in your pocket then? You leave your phone in the dressing room.
Knowing the people,
I think our fans will be telling us exactly where we are.
Yeah. I often hear it. Like, I try not to think, well, I'm not going to look. I hear someone say, oh, why not? And you hear it, you know, you end up knowing.
I find it worse, like, when you're not playing and the other team are, like last night, and you're sitting there, you can't finish training or whatever, and you have a little look at the scores, and you always find yourself going back. Because if you want someone to score against the team, it's like, oh, mate, how long ago?
there was a Brighton seat midweek game 4 or 5 weeks ago, and I think they were, I can't remember who it was against, but I think they were losing. You went to the game. Were they losing, or? And I'd got home from coaching at Colchester.
The one at Bowles? Was it the one at Bowles?
Yeah, the Bowles game. I got home from coaching at Colchester, and I've looked at the score, and it's like, I think it was Bowers 3, Brighton 1. Great. Warmed my dinner up in the microwave, ate it, turned, looked at the phone and went, in the space of warming my dinner up and eating it.
I went to that game and I'm glad I did, because you look and you go, oh, Bowers 3-1, yes, that's... At the game, I knew that even 3-1, Brighton City were going to win that game.
Yeah.
Just the way the game had panned out, Bowers didn't play particularly well on the night, had a man sent off. It was Brighton wave after wave of attack, and if you're not there, you're thinking, then you're really disappointed. But being there, I expected Brighton to win it by watching it.
I think it's more habit, isn't it? Because you've got your phones a lot anyway, so I'll just check the score. So what's happened here? You know what I mean?
One of the reasons I asked that question for is because, on that game where it was Needham and Harlow at the top, and it was, I think, we went to Needham's sort of second last game of the season. I think we were, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was 1-0 down, 2-0 down at half time, and they'd won the league at half time, and it must have been 700-800 people in the ground, and it was a cracking atmosphere. Alex Reid had been out injured and he wasn't playing, and then he brought him on a substitute, and all of a sudden he got it back to 2-2, and Craig Pope missed the last minute chance I could have, well, eventually had won us the title, as it worked out. And then, of course, you went to the last game, and I'm sure it was, if I'm right, I think we were playing Thamesmead over here, I think it was Chatham that was actually playing Needham.
It was at Chatham. Yeah, I went and watched that
then on that day. At one stage, Chatham were winning, and we were winning here. We got the title after, or they were drawing, or something like that.
Yeah, I think Needham won the league.
Yeah, up to about 25 minutes, we were champions. And you could feed it all around the ground and all the rest of it. And all of a sudden, it just went bang, 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 bang,
bang.
Well, fair enough. Okay, we'll start again. Yeah. Go again on Tuesday night, but it is. I personally think it will come to that. I think it will. You don't want to hear that, but I think it will. I think it will come down to that last day of the season.
Yeah.
Who have you got?
So.
I'm sure. Chesson as well.
Yes.
We've got Wroxham away.
Be interested to know on Hornchurch because I've got no Wi-Fi, so I can't get that. Yeah.
Hornchurch got. Berry, I believe, not though.
Away.
No, I think they're at home.
So on paper, I mean, if you look at that, that sort of scenario, if everybody's on the same sort of points, would you expect? But yeah, from being an outsider, you probably might expect you guys to beat Stowell. You'd expect you guys to beat, Wroxham. Then the other two games are probably well up in the air because at that time it could be Brighton sitting down for the title, it could be Chesson trying to get in the playoffs, or cement a home tie in the playoffs or whatever.
I'm quite honest, I don't want to think about that.
Yeah, it could be.
Where does the trophy go? That's the problem, right?
I have to get four.
I mean, that'd be great for neutrals, wouldn't it, Mark?
No, I was wrong, sorry. It's Hornchurch Bowers on the last day of the season.
We could still be in the playoffs.
Chesson Brighton, too.
It's exciting times, aren't it?
Going back to the team I'm tipping for the last place, it's Haringey versus Norwich. There's some absolute crackers.
But you know, and that's one thing, I mean, we'll go into that in a second half, I'm just saying a question that you can think of for the next 5 minutes, we'll come back to you in a minute, but isn't it amazing with this league that when the fixtures come out in August or June, July, and we get into the season, there is what I'd call sort of golden weekends. There's about six or seven of them during the season where there's unbelievable golden weekends where it just all falls into place where you might have you versus Brighton, say you versus Hornchurch, and they all seem to fall into place quite regularly. But we'll be back, as you said, in about 5 minutes' time. I'm just going to go for a little comfort break. We'll be back in about 5 minutes' time. Hopefully on the phone we will have the wounded soldier himself, Mr. McMahon. He'll give us a call in about 5-10 minutes' time. Then we'll talk a lot more about Morden and Tiptree as well. We'll be back with you in probably about 5 minutes' time. And of course, also as well, we'll give you this week's Team of the Week as well. And we're back with the Ryman Roundup show then for the next 50 minutes or so. And chatting to Kevin and Mark from Morden and Tiptree. And of course, Glenn is with us as well. And of course, if you want to send any questions, why not send them through on Facebook, and we'll try and answer any of those for you as well as we go along. Hopefully Keith will give us a call as well. Hopefully we'll get, we'll try and see if we can get Glenn to text him through the number of what the number is. Hopefully Glenn's still got it on his phone. But and hopefully Keith, I'll send it to him in a text message. So Morden Tiptree. I mean, what was, so I said at the beginning of the season, I mean, what was the aim at the beginning of the season for you guys? I mean, was it a case of looking at it and going, right, okay, we're definitely going for promotion here, are we going for safety here, or worst case scenario, are we sort of saying we need to get those 50 points to make sure that we don't go
Win the league.
Win the league, yeah, but my remit was to get Morden Tiptree out of the division, ideally win it, if it had to be the playoff, so it was pretty clear, there was no grey areas really. And so far, so good. Still a long way to go, like we've already spoke about. But that was, and to be fair, that was the one thing that sort of drew me to the job. Really appealed to me that pressure. I've mentioned briefly my time at Chatham. There was no real pressure at Chatham, where they just wanted to survive. Once you'd survive, the games meant nothing. I craved that pressure, probably similar to yourself, Glenn. When you play football, and that's all I've ever done. It was a results business, and you had to win at all costs. And I missed that pressure when I stopped playing, I must admit. It was something that I craved. I wanted to be under pressure, I wanted to have to achieve, and results mean something. So that really appealed to me with Morden. It was black and white, there was no grey areas, get out of this division. The pressure's on, yes, but that was something that I wanted.
We're trying to get hold of Keith. I don't know if this is actually he's there. Is that you, Keeper boy? Okay. Hello. He's trying, desperately trying to get through, but we are struggling.
He dropped his phone and can't pick it up.
Back, yeah. Are you, mate? He may have gone off. So we'll try and get him again in a minute. But yeah, so I mean, I suppose everybody asked the question. I know Mark. I mean, I made the statement the other day about about Brighton City having it in your own hands, and I explained exactly what I meant, about it. But is it a case of, with the young lads you've got, and also do you get a little bit, put out? Shall we say, is the politest way of putting it? Of people saying, oh yeah, but they've got the help of Colchester, and they've got this, and they've got that, and they've got money coming at you, and money coming at there. Does that really annoy you?
It does a little bit, but to be fair, I take
it. I've had two seasons of it.
So. I take it as a compliment because it's different to what people think. We aren't Colchester. We've had a number of games where we've gone and played teams. They go, oh yeah, but you're Colchester. But I've got Femi on loan at Colchester, who's a lad that's played at this level and played in the 23s and done well. And I think he made one appearance in Colchester first team. Not a great deal, but again. The other two I've took are under 18s. They've not played men's football. And the lad earlier, JJ, covered the left back for 3 games. The rest are Morden players. Yeah. Yes, we've got 5 lads that come in and train with the under 23s, but they're Morden players. So when people mention you are Colchester, we're not. I'm part-time Morden manager. Yes, my full-time job is with Colchester 23s. And that's what it is. So I say, so let's take it as a compliment. They think you're Colchester players. It's Morden players that up to this point have had a decent season.
Kate, can you hear us there, mate?
Yeah, I can, Dave. Now you've got that since I'm sorted.
No, it still ain't worked out yet, mate. I'm still trying to work it out, mate. But we'll sort it out later on. We've got you right as close as I can get you to the thing. So how's the back then, mate?
Yeah, painful. Not having a bit for a few days, if I'm honest. But, 3 hours in A&E than holding out. But, nice drive up to the Argyle.
So good result then on Saturday, and then back to sort of, would you say back to square one last night, or would you say still playing quite well?
Nah, last night, mate, was awful, but Saturday, we'll get the Saturday we actually played very well. Should have won the game in the first half, and then we got a little bit for missed chances.
So, I mean, looking up to the weekend then, with Waltham Abbey, I mean, what's the chances for you down there? Finger on what the problem is?
Yeah, we're rubbish. A lot of clubs out, and we're not just making excuses, but we've had some big players go, and
Keith, there's obviously a bit of a gap, isn't there, between you and the bottom three?
Not really
going to happen, will it? No, I know, mate. But are you looking at a target, you know, just to, you know, give the boys a goal, you know?
Yeah, eight goals.
No, but you know what I mean, like one or two wins?
He's probably still talking though as well. Yeah, he was mid flow down.
Yeah, a little bit.
Is that fine?
It is, isn't it? Quite fine. Sorry, mate, we lost you for a minute. So I mean, is it? Oh, he's back again. He loves it. Yeah. All right, mate. Oh, I don't know. We can't get it connected. We didn't get much of it at all. If I'm honest, go for it, mate. That's it. Yeah, go on, mate. What was your...
No,
I mean, we haven't spoke for a couple of weeks as such on the show wise, but I mean, you, going on to the guests we've got in the studio, I mean, for you, I mean, is it Morden for the title, or is it Brighton City or Hornchurch?
I've got some good players up at Brighton, and so I'm just... Leicester and I do think Hornchurch, you don't want to get them in the playoffs if they're in there.
We were just looking at the last games of the season, and just in case it comes down to that, and there is some unbelievable games. Last game of the season for everybody that's involved in. Yeah.
Yeah.
Morgan's
Sullivan, I think, Roxon.
Yeah. Well, we just had one question come in, and I know probably best one for Mark to answer, because I know he's got a little bit about this sort of stuff. But Richard Buckby?
Yeah.
Has said, Lebs/Kev, can you just say how many Colchester United players we actually have?
We have one on loan.
Femi on loan, and two of the under-18s are signed on, but they're not in the squad because obviously everyone's fully fit now, so... Femi was a big coup for us, really, and we're really fortunate again because we don't have the choice of everyone. Obviously, for it to work for Colchester, it's got to be right for the player. Mm. And in all honesty, I didn't expect to get Femi. He went out to Bishopsthorpe for, I think, he scored 7 in 9, so smashed it up a couple of leagues above in a struggling team. So I expected him to go out on loan elsewhere, I must admit, and it didn't happen. And Femi needed to play football, so I was able to offer him that. So I was over the moon to get Femi. I must admit, he's something a little bit different to what we've got. He's that big centre forward that's really physical. Absolutely. And direct, yeah. And quick. And
but if you had the choice of Bishop Stortford or Mark Morden, you'd go with Morden. Sorry? We literally just asked Kevin that, and he said that he's happy with what he's got. So,
here we go.
Yeah.
Ferguson, when it always strength from,
yeah,
from strength.
Yeah.
I think for us, talking about Morden, I think because we've been without the likes of Sam Newsome for so long, Curtis Haynes-Brown's not played nowhere near enough football this season due to injury. They're like two new signings for us as well, and massive, massive players for us. So we're not really in need of anyone with a fully fit squad.
Yeah. I mean, I've just said Mark Coleman, is that anybody? Yeah, Mark.
Needham.
He's basically said here, Kevin, are you free on Sunday, March the 19th for a charity game? And he's underneath that says, guys, can you say tickets are still available for Sunday, March the 19th? Needham Market charity team versus an Arsenal charity team. Tickets available from Mark. So
potentially. What day is that on the Sunday?
Sunday the 19th of March.
Potentially. Tell him I'll get back to him.
There you go. If he's listening, he's got to be listening. I'm going to talk.
That must be charity if he wants me to still play.
I thought Arsenal was a charity team anyway. There we go. But I mean, while you're on there, and I know it's away from the rhyme and stuff, and we spoke to Danny Cowley last week talking about Arsenal. I mean, what a fantastic achievement that was over the weekend for Lincoln, and okay, Sutton couldn't do it, but do you fancy Lincoln to do it?
Final.
you agree with
him? I think it's a step too far, but the fact that we're even sat here talking about it is unbelievable. They will be hoping that they play out their skins, and Arsenal would obviously have to have a massive off day.
But I think one thing did happen from that game, and I'm not talking about the pies either or nothing like that, but one thing that did happen after the game, and I bet the vice chairman of the league was pulling his hair out. And I don't know if you saw the pictures of the Arsenal dressing room once they left. Mm. I bet you Craig Johnston was going bonkers. What do you think?
Yeah, it reminded me of those old times.
I think the 50 grand they've just donated to them, something to blow them.
Yeah, it's one of those things. You'd expect them to have a little bit more.
To be fair, we've had a little bit of trouble with it this year.
Yeah.
There's no need for it, to be fair. We're pretty strict on it now. The lads manage it themselves. We nominate a couple of players to do it. I just think it's the right thing to do. Leave it as you found it. Mm-hmm. Hopefully take 3 points with you and leave with a little bit of respect. Mm.
You had anything like that down your place this year, Keith?
Leave it a little bit, you know, as you found it, and treat
him
with a bit of respect.
That
some clubs don't. So.
All I will say is we did it a couple of times away and got pulled up on it. The lads were like it at our place as well. So we've said it all across the board, home or away, go play your game, get showered, clear up, and leave and do it right. I think it's a good way to go.
Well, I think most clubs like us have got a kit man, and we let him do it.
Yeah, well, we've got lads, fellas that go in and do it, and I just think these people that do the odd jobs, every club's got them. The clubs wouldn't exist without them. I just think at times it's putting a little bit too much on them, and a little bit taking liberties. So
it's not a bad thing for particularly our young lads to do. It's a bit like the old-fashioned thing about cleaning boots if you're an apprentice.
So Keith, I mean, I know you're a fair bit away, but I mean, what have you got anything you'd like to ask Mark or Kevin?
Really, obviously, you've covered it. I listened to the first half of the show as well, and the second part. I heard they thought their main rivals will be, and Kevin was absolutely right, to beat the sides below them is more important than sometimes the sides around them. But, you know, I think, what home games have they got left? Have they got more home games in a way, or is it just...
Five and five. We're 5-5, Keith.
Well, that's 15 points at home, mate. So who's got home, Kev, anyone?
Do you know what, I'm just looking now for you, mate.
Averley is the highest place side at the moment that we've got left to play at home.
Yeah, we play Averley at home, Brentwood at home, Wroxham, Dereham, Heybridge, Swifts, local derby, second from last game of the season.
Yeah. As you know, Heybridge, you know, are pretty solid there, but then because it's been a local derby, maybe that's been a tough one. But I think Harrogate haven't got them either, but the side you don't want to play at the moment, and everyone knows him, but mate, anyway, away is Phoenix, because their away record at the moment is fantastic.
Yeah, we're done.
Well, just looking, you know, Kevin's just pulled up his phone, and you look at some of the games, you know, that Morden have got. You know, I know, I had sort of a conversation with Mark around bits and bobs, but you actually look at it and see that it's very, very away. Averley at home, Chesham away, Brentwood at home, Thamesmead away, Wroxham at home, Dereham at home, Romford away, and then Heybridge Swifts at home, and Somme away last game of the season. I think if you was, this is no pressure on the two guys sitting in front of me, but I think if Carlsberg did fixtures, then they might be the ones you'd pick.
There's a couple of tricky away.
That makes it dangerous, though. Yeah.
But as we... No, but as we said earlier, we believe we've got a group that's capable of going and winning all of those games, and that's the way we're approaching it.
I mean, yourself, Keith, I mean, I know you just said you'd like to, but I mean, do you see you know, Morden or Brightley City has added two that are there, both on 75 at the moment. You know, do you see those two as being the main two teams?
Yeah, you've got obviously they've been solid all the time. We expected Morden to be there because obviously the quality they've got and the fact that a fair play at Brighton, see they've hung in there, and I think a lot of people thought they might have sort of faded away after Christmas. So Anthony Dewey Hunt and that's going to make a massive difference to them. I still think Farrell's the right in there with them. I think, as I said a few weeks ago, Dave, I think it's going to go down to the last game. There is some little twists and turns. It's never plain sailing all the way in. You know, most of these sides will win most of their games, but it's going to be the one that does slip up here or there. But, Morgan's firepower is decent, and that's what I think may get them over the line.
I just see that Jimmy's 1-0 up tonight.
Get in there. He's set off.
Not yet, no. Did you actually ask him about that? Because when he was on the show, he turned around and said about our the chairman had said to him, calm down, Jimmy, calm down, after his first game got sent off. And then he came on the radio one day, come on the show, didn't he, on the Monday, and then got sent off on the Tuesday.
Yeah, I asked him because I said about the referee. If you tell me why he got sent off as well, which is an absolute joke. Referee don't know the rules.
He didn't ask him to take the player off again, did he?
Yeah, no, they're trying to play out the back though, and what they do is they let their two centre-halves go in the box, and the centre-forwards from Tunbridge wouldn't get out the box, and kept running across, and the referee let him do it, so Jim started telling the rules, and the referee said,
But with yourselves then, are you still, we were looking at it and saying maybe three or four more points needed, and is that what you think yourself really?
Yeah, I think one more win, Dave, and we're fine. As I said, we're not looking. After the Hayridge game, we actually sat there and thought we'd win a couple of games in hand. We could, push ourselves maybe sort of towards, 12th, 11th place with the sum of the youngsters we've got. But, I'd say one more win, and then, that opens up. It's a 10-point gap or 11-point gap. We've got Wroxham, Waltham Abbey, Brentwood, all to play. So, I think the highest paid side, we've got Averley and Bowers. I think they're the two highest sides we've got left to play.
We both think you're probably you'll still be okay, but I went down to see Waltham Abbey and Brentwood at the weekend, and it wasn't the greatest game in the world to say the least, and that's probably being quite fair.
Yeah, Waltham Abbey is a difficult place to go, with the pitch and the surroundings there, and they're lovely people, and we're there Saturday, and let's just hope we can get a result. But I was listening last week, though, to the show as well, wasn't here, and you can stick that predictive league up your own.
I haven't looked at it actually. I don't know if anybody's got it on their phone. We can bring it up when it says this week, but it's.
Well, we're still not going to win the league. It hasn't had us winning the league all season, so we're still not.
But as we said last week, I think it was a season before last. I think it was early in the season, and one week they had Farrell winning the league when me and Keith looked at it. And then the next week, on the Saturday, they lost, and they were getting relegated the week after. I just don't know how they actually predict predict the scores in the first place.
Listen, I think it's the people that beat the referees. I mean, they pick it. I don't think any manager probably looks at the kick this table.
I'm playing FIFA, innit? To win all that with the league, it's a joke. I'll tell you one question to ask you, and I don't know if you heard us say it before. And I know Ray Dyer, if he's listening, would probably be able to sort of straight away come in and say what it is. We've got this situation where I'm sure it's a league rule that you have to use your football web pages.
Right.
All right, saying that? I think it's a case of. I think you have to put Thurrock don't use it. I mean, I think there's about three or four teams in the top league that don't use it in the top tier as well. And I thought that was something that you had to do.
Yeah, I don't think it's a league rule, mate. I think it's going to you have a designated person to tweak the goals, but not put your teams in. I don't think I'm not 100%, you know, I can't see you having a league rule that you've got a city team on a website that don't even sponsor it, but I think it was just a thing that would give more publicity to the league and your club.
Mm. I know, it was only the other day I was trying to see the old boy next to who was playing, but you couldn't go and let it see.
No, I keep looking at that as well, see how many minutes he gets.
Well, didn't complete the game at Malden.
Did you start it?
No, I was just out there. Yeah, no, I keep getting 90s, mate, other than that. Still doing right, mate.
Good luck, you look fit in that tracksuit, mate.
Cheers, mate. Still fitting, isn't it? It's all them hours of work I'm doing, mate.
Listen, Keith, I know you're in a lot of pain and everything, mate, so thanks for phoning in. And if you're fit enough, then hopefully we might see you back in here with us on Monday night.
Yeah, I'll be back, mate. And if I've upset anyone, it's because I've got too much
diazepam. Listen, mate, we'll let you go. And then say, hopefully, I'll see you Saturday anyway, because I'm going to pop down Saturday to watch the game. So you ain't got Danny Lee playing up front, you'll be all right.
Okay,
see you later, mate. See you later, mate. As I say, he's a great guy, and I must admit, you know, and to say last, I think it was last week or week before, it was actually 2 years since he's been with me on doing the show, and he's a massive part of the show, and so he has been with us for the last two or three weeks through football problem issues, and then of course now health issues. I suppose with the league itself, I mean, he's. What was at the beginning of the season? You've got everybody together. I mean, but tell us a little bit more about the club in general itself. I mean, Malden Chichester, people behind the scenes, new sides have you got? Have you got reserve sides and ladies sides possibly? I don't know. I mean, give us a bit more insight to Malden itself.
Well, I suppose I'll answer this one because I've been here longer than you. This is my second season. We've got a youth section. Go through from toddlers, I think under sevens, I'm not sure, under eight, something like that, up to under 18s. No under 21s, no reserve side. Don't know if we've got a ladies section. Richard Buckby, we should text him and answer that one, but not aware that we've got a ladies section. That's it really. It's a pretty normal club from that point of view. The only difference between us and anybody else is this link that we have with Colchester, where some of our boys can go in and train during the day.
I think that's really important, the youth section side of it. Maybe it's because I sort of come through that myself, and being first team manager, I like to try and show interest. I know it's very difficult with the fixtures you have, the training. But I've tried to include the under-18s in training sessions a couple of times. I just think it's important if they've come through from a young age through one club, there's got to be some sort of pathway for them if they're good enough.
And a goal, wouldn't
they? And a goal, something to strive to, because quite often clubs that haven't got that, or they fall away at 16, 17, and haven't got the 18s and potentially a 21s, which may be something we need. You end up finding these players playing in the same division or maybe the division above. Oh yeah, I was at Morgan until Southwest. So there's players out there, there's very good players out there, and it's important, as I believe, as a first team manager or management staff, that we show interest in the kids. And it's always obviously they're not going to know who we are from Adam there, but if parents see that first team manager's here and he's shown interest in my kid that's coming through this football club, I think that's really important. Gives the club a bit more identity as well.
One of our lads who's on a full-time basis, Taran Alarakia, we got out of Averley's youth side last year. So there's great reasons to have a youth section. I know Tommy has got the youth section at Thurrock and it's very strong and all.
Yeah, we watched reserves Monday night, me, the gaffer, Tommy, and two of the boys came on for Saturday because we've got a couple of suspensions and injuries, and they're doing really well. And I mean, two of the boys played against me. They played for Averley EJA side, which is bizarre.
Yeah.
Played against my Redbridge boys, and they stood out like a sore thumb. to be fair, and like you said, it's so important.
It is, because you don't know how much that, by even coming in, admittedly it hasn't happened too often at Morden, just through circumstances and the amount of games we've had, but even coming to training, like them young lads coming in and training with likes yourself, that's going to bring them on no end, learning off you. And
yeah, well I did the Redbridge 18s when I was like 21, 22, and when Craig was manager at Redbridge, and I always said, like Craig, I'm going to send 3 players maximum every week to train with us on Thursday. He's like, yeah, fine. Mm-hmm. And about 4 or 5 of them ended up playing, and well, Kenny Davies is one, and he's a Bournemouth that still, you know, that played non-league football, and I just think it's so important. And, you know, obviously if you go up next year as well, it's a bigger, you know.
Yeah, the big one for me, and I'll always use him as a shining light to all the kids, the lad Kieran Morphew, Needham Market. I had him at Needham Market Academy, and he had admitted to you himself he wasn't the most gifted footballer. He had great attitude. He came in, he didn't play at first, he was sub for the academy team, and he got in the team, and then he went trained for, and all of a sudden he's gone on, he's outstanding. He's outstanding. What he does, I think he's probably first name on Mark's team sheet when he's fit. So there is players out there. I think he was just playing local football at the time.
Well, Richard's come in and said, you think he's got one female side, under 15s.
All right.
He says he thinks, and he's also said that football web pages, you only have to do such thing as goals and attendance. Yes, it is a league rule, and you get fined if you don't. And what do you guys think of the dressing room celebrations, which are pictured all over Twitter and Facebook after just one win?
Poor form.
I'm not into that, though.
Glenn and I have had this discussion about, well, you don't get too high when you win and you don't get too low when you lose. And our dressing room's been like that all season. We have been on the opposite end of some quite wild celebrations where clubs have then posted that on social media, which I find personally is bad form. It's not something we do.
I think as players, you've got to sort of take it on the chin and let it spur you on a bit. I'm not really into it. I agree with Mark massively on don't get carried away too much when you win, and don't get too low when you don't. Ups and downs are unbelievable.
Are you sort of on this sort of, if you're in the dressing room, you've lost a game, are you one of these sort of management teams where you undo your, if their celebrations are kicking off big style in the other dressing room, are you one of these sort of management duos that undo the door and let them listen to it?
Quite often in the grounds we play, and you can't help but listen to it.
And especially recently, where we forgot to bring our own music box as well, so we had no choice.
Yeah. We've asked them to turn the music up a few times, but it is what it is, and I ain't got no problem with teams doing that. One of my teams wouldn't do it. Just for the fact, like I said, I don't think you can get carried away. Things can change so quickly. You can go from winning run to a losing run of 6 games, and you then look silly. So
I mean, I have been a part of that with Billy Ricky. We did it, and they still do it. The difference is now they're putting it on social media, which, you know, not just them, there's others as well that sort of then rub it in that little bit more. And I mean, not every time you'd want to see it. I mean, if you win a game, you might not necessarily be happy with your personal performance, and you know, for me, I would, like I said, I wouldn't do it if I was a manager personally. But you know, sometimes, I mean, you can use it to your advantage. I mean, Andy Scott did it with us at Brentford when Hereford won the league at our place. He opened the door in the second of the last game and went, boys, that's what it's like to win a promotion. He said, that's what you've got to do next year. Do you know what I mean? So, but that's a, you know, different circumstance, because they'd just won the league. I wouldn't imagine they was doing that every week. Do you know what I mean? But, you know, as Mark said, I think putting it on social media, for me, it's just a case of rubbing it in, and it's just... social media, a lot of it is ego anyway, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? I think that's just what it is, to be honest.
Well, if anybody wants to speak for the last 10, 15 minutes of the show, you want to speak to any of the guys in the studio, it's 07510175423. That's 07510175423. I suppose one of the other things, I suppose, as well, is it... might be not a great question to ask, I suppose, in one way, but do you get to a situation where it's easier... Kevin, do you think that people, if a player comes in and it's Kevin Horlock speaking to him rather than, say, whoever, another manager, is it easier for you to get players in? Do you find it easier to get players in because you're Kevin Horlock rather than if you was...
I'm not sure. I would like to think it's the fact that they can see what we're trying to do at Maldon and the way we go about things. Does it have an effect on it? Potentially, I suppose it could. But I love my hands. I'm quite new to this game in terms of management. I spent 6 months at Chatham and this season at Maldon. So I'm not an experienced manager. I'm learning like everybody else is. I think you continually learn as a manager or as a coach. So they're not coming to a really experienced manager. Yes, they're coming to someone that played football and had a half-decent career that knows what it takes to potentially get there, and I could help them in that respect. But I don't know. I would like to think it was a mixture of the both, but less being because it's me.
I mean, do you feel as well, you know, as ex-professional footballer and the same sort of thing with Jimmy as well, would you like to see more guys come down and try and cut their teeth in the management game at this sort of level, rather than sort of going jumping straight into league football or Premiership football?
I think it's a really good thing. I know people are different, and I must admit, when I first finished playing football, I didn't know whether I wanted to be a coach. I didn't know whether I wanted to be a manager. I was a little bit naive in the fact that I thought I was going to play football forever, and not until it happened. I'm glad the way I did it. I started off a coaching business, going into schools, after school clubs, and loved it, and thought that was all I would do. Then the opportunity came at Needham to do the academy there. So again, we started it from nothing. I was washing kit, driving minibuses, sorting fixtures, doing everything. I'm really glad the way it's progressed. Yes, I'm 44 now, and I've finally got into Colchester, so I'm at a professional club, and now doing the Maldon side of it as well, which ticks all the boxes for me. But I'm glad I had that apprenticeship where I've seen most things now. So hopefully I'm more equipped to deal with things that come in the future, and I feel like I've earned it, not got given the role just because I play football.
Obviously, you played at the top level and played a lot of managers. What would you say your management style, who is it most similar to manage Jim?
We mentioned it briefly. I like to be very level. I don't get carried away with wins or two down with defeats, although I tend to take the defeats home a little bit more than I do the wins. Quite calm and collective. You don't see it rarely, well, you won't see me rant on the sideline. I might shout odd things on to players. I never really got on at the ref. I just think if you're doing that and screaming and shouting, I know everyone's got their own style, and again, I respect that. I think, one, lads won't listen to you, and you're losing a little bit of focus. I talk in a calm, collective manner. I don't really shout at half time.
No, you haven't thrown any teacups this year.
I just don't think you get response as a player. I wouldn't.
This is the first season we've worked together, so I can't comment before.
I just go off how I was at a player. If a manager's shouting, for me, I think you switch off after a couple of minutes.
Yeah.
The lads know what they're doing before the game, so we prepare properly, we train properly, we have a focus on what we're trying to do, and the lads know that. So for me to shout on instructions means, one, I'm losing it, or two, they've not understood what I've told them, so I'm quite calm and collected.
But also, quite often, Kevin allows them to prop themselves.
Yeah.
So, quite often, at half-time, we'll go into our office, if we're at home, we'll let them have their couple of minutes and then come back, and then Kevin will probably prompt them with some questions around what's happened, how can we solve the problem, and 99 times out of 100, they know the answers anyway, and we deal with it that way. So there is, joking aside, there is no throwing of teacups, there is no raised voices.
And I think that's important as a player. They're playing the game, I'm not playing the game anymore. So if there is issues, obviously I'll address it and say, look, this will work. And I just think it's important they have input into that. They're playing it, they might have problems, or they might see themselves having problems that maybe I haven't seen. So I think it's important to have that interaction with players.
Mm. Well, managers that you come across in the North Division, I said mainly for yourself, I mean, and yourself maybe for the Premier as well, but do you look at managers? Is there certain managers out there that you look at and you've got massive respect for them? The manager in the sort of three rivals with the Eastern leagues that we've got, is there a manager out there that you look at and you think, do you know what, you know, you think about, you might not have ever played for him or whatever it was, but you look at it and think, do you know what, I really think he's the man, you know.
For me, someone I played for, Craig, because if it wasn't for Craig, you know, I would have quit football, because I come out of the programme, you know what it's like, you disillusioned sometimes, and I was 20 and left Yeovil, and it was like, right, do I really want to do this? I was working, and you just do become disheartened. And I just was strolling around the football pitch, just, you know, and he come in and, you know, left me out one game, and I was top scorer, to be fair. And then he just instilled a work ethic in me. He said, if you work hard, you'll be able to get back to where you want to be, and show the confidence in me. And if it wasn't for him, then I wouldn't have, you know, gone and played in the league. I mean, it weren't for, you know, it wasn't all my career, but I had a decent career, you know, non-league, top level non-league. And if it wasn't for him, I know he didn't pick me in his best bit of Ricky 11. Well, I know the reason why, Craig. But yeah, no, I mean, and from not playing, and obviously the gaffer I'm with now as well, but I've only played for him in the Ryman this year. But Kev as well, respect Kev and Mark, obviously, the work they're doing at Maldon, and it was actually quite interesting to watch you guys working at clubs when I was sat with the ump for coming off, you know, because you didn't shout, and it was a calm, you know, and you was letting the boys, you know, do their stuff. And
inside I was doing backflips, but I don't love to see that.
Yeah.
I think you have moments in your career or people you stand alongside and you think, oh, I like that, and then you try and take bits off everyone. Someone I admire and I always will is Danny Laws down at Sudbury. I know he's not doing first team football anymore, he's doing the academy down there, but when I first stopped playing, he gave me the opportunity to go to Needham. The moment I see him working with young players, I knew it was a place I wanted to be. I wanted to, at the end of my obviously professional career, I wanted to be at a club where there was young players, a young manager that had new ideas and delivered it really well. So he's someone I look up to.
Yeah. I think Kev mentioned earlier about Gavin Rose. That's someone that I respect because he's not only doing well for his club, he's doing well for individual players by kicking them on and having pro contracts, obviously pro clubs, and still keeps churning out good teams and playing the right way, you know. And I think, you know, for me, Gav is one that stands out.
I mean, for me, and this is only as a fan watching, you know, when teams come here or you go to their ground, for me, the one that I've mentioned loads of times on this show, that I've just got some kind of real respect for coming on the radio, he's Mark Moresby at Needham Market. I just think the guy has produced absolute miracles, you know, this year, you know, and even the year when, you know, even the year when it was, you know, Harlow and them down at the top of the table, you know, he really did keep sort of a level head. He wasn't sort of, he came on the show a few times, he wasn't giving it the big I am or anything like that whatsoever. He kept his cool all the way through, even at the game, you know, at half time, you know, he came over and shook me by the hand, even though he was tuned up, and there was no sort of like, oh, we've won the league here, or, you know, it's a funny comment or anything like that. So, and the guy was just brilliant. Even when he comes here and he's in the boardroom here, he'd always come up and, you know, and he'd bring me a
ball face out. Top man.
Just
top
different.
Man. I think it's just the way you got to be, though, isn't it? You know, you've got to be a nice guy.
It's
as well as a good manager.
Really successful as well. For me, what's to go? I worked with him for a couple of years at Needham. His management skills are really good. I think he's a big Man City fan. I think he said he had a picture of me above his bed at some point. No, to be fair, he's done an unbelievable job at Needham, flying high. I did actually, over the phone, agree to go back there to start the season before I got offered the Morgan job, which obviously then changed things for me. But I've got massive respect for Mark. I speak to him now and again. And again, he's someone that people might think, because I play football, I wouldn't want to learn from. Mark's the most successful manager in my eyes at this level in our area. So I look at managers like that and say, what could I take off him and use to make me better?
A couple of people have sent some funny bits in, so we'll read this. Ryan Scott said Glenn Paul for England. Billy Lumley said, question for Glenn Paul, who's the chubbiest player you've played with?
Well, there's only one candidate, that's Richard Aller. But I'll also throw in that there's two candidates for the biggest nose, and Lumley's one of them, and Steve Sheehan's the other one. So, and Scotty, come on, what time is it in Australia, mate?
We're
going to work, surely.
Ryan Anderson agreed, gents, enjoy the wins, but the season is long and will be ups and downs. Adam Drew said, you're listening, Bishop Upby, don't get onto the ref. Who does Kev model himself as gaffer? So who does Kev model himself as gaffer? You see him a wear, you'd think he was Pep.
Ah, I had a Morden tie on the day. To be fair, I'm a pretty superstitious fella. I sort of switch between tracksuit, and now and again I will wear a shirt and a jumper and a tie. I want a Morden tie, that's probably what he's getting.
Billy Lumley's also said, Glenn, if he was a manager, would you sign Richard Haller?
Yeah, because I need a kit man.
But, I mean, do you look back now then at Man City and wish you were there now?
That'd be nice, wouldn't it? I was actually up there last weekend. We took the 23s up on Sunday playing the Premier League Cup. I stayed over and went in the following day, so it's incredible. The stuff they got there for the kids coming through from every age group is just on another level. If I was there now, I wouldn't be there, because I would be nowhere near their first team. So, yeah, that's the answer to that, but it's incredible. And to be fair, they deserve it in terms of the fan base. It was unbelievable. The depths we went to at one point, Man City was scary for the size of the club, and the fans stuck by us, so every success they get, they deserve.
So when was you actually with Man City? When around the Gillingham game?
Yeah, I scored in that one. I went there in 97. I played in the 99 playoff final. I scored the goal that everyone forgets. The one before Dickoff scored the equaliser. It's unbelievable. And people,
have you told us about that?
I don't know if I've told you about that. Yeah.
You can keep you one, don't.
Yeah, the luminous one. But to be fair, it's a little bit embarrassing. My lad don't understand it. I go up there now and again and take him to games. And as embarrassing as it sounds, I'm worshipped up there because of that day. And I spent 7 years there. They see that as the turning point. If we hadn't gone up there, that year, God knows what would have happened.
It was one of the most amazing games of football you probably ever likely to see.
I want to say amazing football. The turnaround was incredible, yeah.
It's just incredible sort of stuff to see and watch. I mean, it's with the league itself, I mean, is there stuff in there that you look at and you think, well, I'd love to change?
In terms of how it's gone, you mean?
Either how it's gone, or things in the Eastern League itself, that if you could go up to Nick Robinson and say, look, Nick, I think we should change this, and he would change it, or I mean, what sort of thing would you...
Let the top five go up, I suppose. But no, I've loved it. Obviously, it's my first season in the Ryman North. I've really enjoyed it. It's been a roller coaster. There's been times when it's been frustrating when we've not performed and stuff, but as a whole, the season, and I think it's only going to get more exciting with what we've got to come. I think it's been really good. But yeah, it would be nice if you would let five go up this season.
I think it's been good, though. It's been a mutual respect from everyone, because it is so close at the top. And I think, there's mutual respect from all the teams that, we're all good teams. And, unfortunately, there's only one winner.
Yeah,
only one go up, someone's going to miss out. But
I'm going to put a negative on this. I'm going to say that this season, compared to last season, the quality of the officials, unfortunately, is not as good. And, I think we can see here and say that we've been on the right side probably slightly more of bad decisions than the other way round. But we've copped some poor decisions. But overall, quality of the officiating this season isn't... So if I could say anything to the league officials, it is we need to find a way to help.
I think I'll back you up on that, because we was having a discussion. I was having a discussion actually during the game. The very bad Saturday. The younger the referees are, I seem to feel that I as a player, you would think they might be on your level because they're young. Mm-hmm. But I think the younger ones are the ones that are more. What's the word, controversial? I think the older ones, it's like experience, isn't it? But I think there should be more experienced referees reffing a lot more, because it seems to me that there isn't that many older heads than there is youngsters that are starting out. And
I'd say, Glenn, it's the management skills that is the bit that affects the officiating.
Well, I got told Saturday, do an appeal for everything. And I said, yeah, because if I don't appeal, well, am I going to get anything? And he said, you're not going to get anything. I said, I know that. He said, I don't want you shouting for everything. I said, ref, you can't tell me to not, And, I mean, he wasn't that bad. I thought he made a few dodgy ones, but...
It's a difficult one, isn't it? I must admit, I don't really get involved with referees. Maybe that's just the way I am. It is a tough job they got, and I do agree with you, there has been some really strange decisions. I think maybe, and I know it probably ain't ever going to happen, sometimes I think if an ex-player an actual lad that, or woman that's played football officiates, I think they maybe see it a little bit different. Mm. If they haven't, they get given the guidelines and it's black or white and they don't see the grey areas. Mm. Will we ever get that stage with ex-players? I know there's a few, and to be fair, I don't know his name, which I apologise for, but there was an ex-player that refereed one of ours recently and he was really good.
Was it Steve Palmer?
Deep Edge South End, yeah.
Yeah.
I think it's the best we've had. Mm. And I think it may be, because he's played the game as well.
Yeah.
Well, a few more questions, just to finish with. James Colasanti, have you asked Kevin and Mark which Ryman side has given the hardest game this season?
Well, to be fair,
we had a good game.
Yeah, that was a very good game.
There's been several, I suppose the biggest defeat we've had is Avery, is it?
Biggest defeat away.
Although we had a lot of possession in that game.
Yeah. The hardest game, Thamesmead at home, sticks in.
Thamesmead should have got something from the game. Mm.
Bill Lumley said, ask Glenn about his spray tan. Hang on a second. Get out of the way, what's going on here? He said, ask him about his spray tan.
Oh, I've seen it. Yeah, spray tan in Magaluf. Yeah. Yeah, it's terrible, Bill. I want to learn, that's the Villa fan.
One of the other ones that was asked as well was a very, famous, we have got women's football in the Rama League, and there was a very famous footballer, retired just recently, and had her last game on Sunday.
Yeah, Kelly Smith.
Kelly Smith. I mean, any thoughts on, have you seen Kelly play, or you've any thoughts on that at all?
Anybody who's at the top of their profession for that long is obviously not only a very good player, but a very good professional. Mm. I've seen him play on the telly.
I mean, I was lucky enough to be there. I actually went on Sunday as well to go and see it, Lee. And I don't think I've seen a game like she couldn't play. Unfortunately, she was managing the team in the end because she's 3 months pregnant. But she I've never seen a game where the respect. I've seen sort of testimonials and stuff like that on the TV in the men's game and that, but the actual respect that everybody had that was playing there for her was unbelievable. You know, every time they scored a goal, they were going up to her, bowing to her in the dugout and stuff like this. And they Howard Webb was reffing the game and gave a stupid penalty at the end, which everybody knew was going to happen. And Kelly came on and walked up and took a penalty and scored and stuff like this. But it was the respect that they had, even when she came on for the penalty. She still got a tracksuit on, and she'd taken the top off with the famous number 10 on her that she wore, and walked under a guard of honour to the penalty spot and stuff like this. And you had, you know, English football players out there like Steph Horton from Man City, you know, an England captain, and there was other people out there as well that were top, you know, Kim Littles and these type of people, Jordan Nobbs, that, you know, top names in the English game for women. But the respect that they actually had for her. And I don't think I've ever seen that in the men's game.
Obviously, women's football's changed unbelievable. It's getting closer and closer to men's football all the time.
Yeah,
and rightly so, by the way. And she's dragged that along to that stage. She never gave up and thought, well, I'm going to give up. And she's carried the flag. Mm. So rightly so.
I mean, for me, and you know, a lot of people would look at me and go, you're an absolute idiot. But for me, massive fan, huge fan, and always have done, and always have been. And for me, she's the best Arsenal player, full stop. Now, that's man or woman, by none. Just an amazing, amazing football player that if, I couldn't say what it would be, but she would get into the Arsenal men's side comfortably if she was on the same, you know, I'm trying to say, same sex or whatever, yeah. She'd walk into that team even now. And for me, although she's retired from the game, she's probably still the best player in this country, you know, in this country, bar none, you know, and yet she's retired, and you know, fully understand why she wants to do that and go into the management game like yourself.
Yeah.
But I just wondered, and somebody else has put it on there as well to ask you what it is. One last question for you. They've asked, have you got any aspirations to managing the program?
I get asked it quite a lot, and in all honesty, even when I was playing, everyone said, oh, do you want to do it? I'm pretty laid back about it all. I don't set myself individual targets to get places. Yes, whatever I do, I want to do it as best I can. Like, for example, like I've come out and said I want us to win the league and I want to be the best I can. If that leads to other things, then it does, but it's not something I've paved out for myself. People ask me even in my career, saying, oh, why didn't you leave when we got relegated? It never ever crossed my mind. If I do say I'm in for the long haul until I get told otherwise, and if that day comes, then great. If it doesn't, I won't lose sleep over it. I'll stay at Morden as long as I'm wanted.
Well, a couple of other bits on it just very quickly. Same old Glenn, always blaming the referees. Scott Ramsey said, played with Glenn at Yeovil, great player. And Anthony Buckley said, Kevin Mark, can you pick out Morden Tiptree's best performance of the season so far?
Deer and Wag
was, I'll go Farrell probably as well as one of them, yeah. Because it was on the back of two losses. When arguably a young squad could start questioning itself, we knew what Farrell were about. We knew they were a really good outfit. And to turn up on the day, albeit 4-0, possibly foul, I don't know. I thought we were a better team on the day, but just to stand toe-to-toe with Farrell at home on the back of them two defeats and win 4-0 was pleasing as a manager, because it showed me that the squad have got real character and gives me real hope and confidence for the remainder of the season.
Well, I'd just like to say time has run away from us massively, so massive thank you to Glenn for being here, and massive thank you to Kevin for giving up his time, and for Mark as well for coming in tonight. And we do wish you all the very, very best for the rest of the season, and hopefully maybe later on when it gets a bit closer to the end of the season, maybe we can come down and bring the show down to Morden and do the show down there with maybe some of your players and some of your fans as well, which would be a great night if you guys could organise that for us.
I'll do you all the best.
Yeah.
I'm sure Ed would like that.
But me, Glenn, and hopefully Keith, we'll be back on Monday night when we will have the main man himself, Mr. Mark Morsley, who will be on the phone to have a chat with us. We've also got in the studio with us as well, we've got Anthony Gow from Walton Casuals will be in the studio with us as well. So until then, keep yourself well. Hopefully you'll get all the points that you want over the weekend. And me and Glenn will see you all at the same time, 7 o'clock, Facebook Live, Twitter Live. And also, of course, don't forget the podcast, and of course now as well in the YouTube channel as well, just look for the Ryman Roundup Show. And we will be back then at 7 o'clock on Monday evening. Until then, good night.